Welcome to Mayo Clinic Sleep Medicine Podcasts, a series for physicians, advanced practice providers, nurses, and other health practitioners treating sleep disorders or interested in learning about state-of-the-art advances in sleep medicine and sleep health. I'm your host, Dr. Michael Silber.
And I'm your co-host, Dr. Maitri Juna. We are both consultants at the Center for Sleep Medicine at the Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota.
RO appliances are widely prescribed for obstructive sleep apnea, but they're generally provided by dentists, and sleep medicine physicians and advanced practice providers are not always familiar with the nuances of their fabrication and use. My guest today is Dr. Subha Giri, Assistant Professor of Dentistry at Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota, and an expert on dental therapies for obstructive sleep apnea. Subha, let's start with the indications and contraindications to oral appliances for OSA. Must a patient have failed CPAP therapy before most insurances will pay for an oral appliance, or can it be an initial choice by the patient or the provider? Now, I recognize, of course, it varies between insurances, but what's your general experience with this?
Thank you, Dr. Silber. Oral appliances, since the 2015 guideline, that was a joint guideline from ASM and AADSM, American Academy of Sleep Medicine, and the American Academy of Dental Sleep Medicine, have been used as first preferred therapy by the patient or the provider in mild to moderate severity of obstructive sleep apnea. But for severe sleep apnea in particular, it follows the gold standard trial with the CPAP first and establishing any intolerances by the patient and the provider preference, then subsequently oral appliance can be attempted in that scenario.
And that is agreed on by insurances. I mean, they follow those
Correct.
Guidelines and you haven't run into trouble.
We haven't clinically run into any trouble with that.
Wonderful. Thank you. So which patients do best? You've already told me mild and moderate sleep apnea. Do patients with positional sleep apnea do better than those with non-positional?
Clinically, we do not see a clear delineation between positional and non-positional in terms of response to oral appliance therapy. There's some emerging evidence with respect to certain design features of the oral appliance that may tag along with position, such as using elastic bands for mouth closure may perform better in positional sleep apnea. And so in our practice, we use elastic bands with majority of the appliances to accommodate for that.
Okay. And what about anomalies of jaw and bony structures and teeth? Do people do better if there's retrognathia or worse, or is it really irrelevant for benefit?
That has been a bit of a holy grail in oral appliance therapies to be able to predict using clinical features such as retrognathia and so on. Unfortunately, once again, we do not have a clear delineation there to be able to predict and prognosticate based on that.
Okay, so not to worry what the jaw looks like. If it's mild or moderate sleep apnea, send them along if that's their preference. Great.
Absolutely.
Now, but what about the contraindications? What are the situations in which you really don't want to apply an appliance? For instance, how many natural teeth do you need in the mouth? And can it be used with implants?
It can definitely be used with fixed screw systems such as implants in place of natural teeth, including implants, 8 healthy teeth on the upper arch and 8 healthy teeth on the lower arch is a minimum requirement to be able to fabricate an oral appliance that would stay put during sleep. And that would be an indication. So therefore, in the absence of those many teeth, the appliance is really not something that we want to attempt.
Oh, that's a very useful rule of thumb for people to remember. 8 in the upper jaw, 8 in the lower jaw. Now, what about TMJ, temporomandibular joint dysfunction? Is that a contraindication? Does it worsen TMJ? Does it make it better? What is your thoughts about that?
It is a complex enough condition, temporomandibular disorders, temporomandibular disorders as a gamut of conditions that could occur in the jaw, including muscular versus joint. So therefore, we do approach it on a case-by-case scenario with individual patients. As a rule of thumb, severe and acute forms of temporomandibular disorders, we avoid the oral appliance. Mild to moderate forms of temporomandibular disorders, we can proceed with caution with oral appliance. In fact, there are some scenarios where splinting of the jaw gently forward improves joint status for those patients. So we do have to identify who that is who's going to respond favorably there.
Okay. Now, what about the patient who also has bruxism?
Bruxism is a common co-occurrence in this population of patients with obstructive sleep apnea. So it really is not a contraindication for us to proceed with an oral appliance. In fact, it may be a bonus. The only caution there is that certain design features of the appliance may make the device more durable for those patients with bruxism that is co-occurrent. So we may prefer those designs.
Oh, good. Okay, now there are many appliances on the market. Now the American Academy of Sleep Medicine recommends only custom-made titratable appliances, but even then, there are many on the market. Are any better than others? What are your personal preferences and why?
There are about 150 FDA-approved appliances in the market for sleep apnea management. And CMS does provide us an approved list of appliances. That's about roughly 60 or so. But in our practice, we prefer devices based more so on the features. Even if you take the 150 or so devices, you can trickle them down into certain design features or material that would be the top five materials or top five features of the device. So we then balance it with patient needs. For example, some patients I do have to, as I mentioned earlier, for bruxism, favor a certain type of attachment feature on the device. And for other patients, if their gums are weak, another feature. So even though I may not be able to provide a list of brands, I do bring it down to a top three to five appliances that we pick from for the patient.
So it sounds like one really has to have specialized knowledge of this. It's not something that a general dentist can just say, you know, I had someone visit me with advertising this particular appliance, so I'm going to try it.
It's agreed. Agreed. Okay. As having been a dentist prior to acquiring this training, I would see that even myself, I have a much better knowledge-based approach this today than otherwise.
Okay. So when you refer a patient for an oral appliance, do you do any imaging? Do you do dental x-rays or CTs or anything at all? In an average patient who doesn't obviously have a lot of dental problems, or is it just a clinical judgment of what you're going to use and how you're going to do it? It's unfortunately for most of us a little bit of a black box. We send the patients to you and we don't really know what happens to them. I think our fellows know better than we do because, you know, as you know, we rotate our sleep fellows through the dental department. What do you do in terms of imaging or no imaging?
A typical new patient referred to us will receive a screening radiograph, what we call as a panoramic X-ray, panoramic radiograph, which essentially captures one view, a panoramic view of jaw joints, the teeth, and the dentoalveolar bone. It's a preliminary view to eliminate any subclinical conditions that need to be prioritized but before oral appliance therapy is begun. So we use that radiograph that we obtain on our side. Of course, if they have a local dentist, that radiographs are made available to us, those are bonus, but that's not something we obtain from them.
Okay, good. So now let's talk about the difficult area of how effective are those appliances. Now, there have been many outcomes used, and every time you read a study, it's a different set of outcomes. And this can be very confusing to patients, let alone to physicians. Do you have one or two simple, realistic metrics you use that you can explain to patients so that they have realistic expectations, but understand what may happen?
Okay, so this is definitely the tricky part of what oral appliance therapy outcomes are to be communicated back to the patient. So the way we explain it to them is after starting to use the oral appliance, at a four-week mark, we do a video follow-up with them, a telehealth follow-up with them, to check in on first acclimation and usage of the device. We want them to establish continuous hours of sleep duration time frame, the use of the appliance. Following that, once we check in on that, we talk about their subjective responses in terms of their chief complaint, whatever brought them in for a sleep assessment. Per their medical provider's records, we know it's primarily a report of snoring or daytime sleepiness. And so we do have a verbal check-in with them at the time of that follow-up to see if they're starting to notice some subjective improvements in addition to successfully acclimating to the device. And then we instruct them to return to their medical provider after 75% of mandibular protrusion is achieved. What do I mean by that? Well, at the time of initial assessment, we do measure their maximum protrusive ability. And we tell them either you notice this obvious improvement in your symptoms and or you've achieved a maximum of 3/4 of that titration, 75% of their jaw movement forward. And those two endpoints come together for us to refer them back to a medical provider for a review of their sleep outcomes completely.
Okay. When you do send them back to us, we almost always, not always, but almost always will do some sort of sleep study to assess whether this is has been effective, usually a home sleep apnea test, but it will vary from patient to patient. Is there any progress to developing appliances that can measure hours of use or even efficacy, just as we do with CPAP?
Well, I do believe 2025 or even 26 could be that year when we see commonplace use of devices with a chip or a smart sensor in them for assessing compliance and hours of use. There are devices that are being tested right now in trials to see the safety and the efficacy of that methodology. And I do anticipate that that's not too far out to start seeing that.
Well, that will be very helpful. But let's just get back to the first visit when you see the patient and they ask you, what is the probability? What is the chance that this is going to be effective in curing my sleep apnea? What do you tell them then?
Usually I say mild to moderate severity of sleep apnea. There's a 75% chance that you notice that outcome to be successful. For severe forms of sleep apnea, that probability drops significantly. And therefore, every single person needs to be retested and reviewed for those outcomes to be established.
And the 75% is all sleep apnea will go away, or it will be reduced from moderate to mild?
It'll be 50% reduction in their AHI number. That's usually the marker we use. So if they started out with 15, so 7 to 8 will be the endpoint that they could anticipate to happen.
Okay, so that's what we should bear in mind. A 75% chance of a 50% reduction in AHI for mild or moderate sleep apnea. Okay, now, what are the adverse effects? What are the negative things a patient should expect from wearing the device?
The most common side effect that is immediate, that is reported by the patient, is a change to the amount of saliva in their mouth. Either they notice excessive saliva right away when they put the device in the mouth. So therefore, we have them acclimate for short windows of time when they're awake first, the first week of use, 15 minutes of use here and there, to acclimate to that sensation. And then when they start leaving it in overnight, the reverse tends to happen in the first couple of weeks where they have more of a drier mouth. And so the changes to salivary flow is the first thing that is reported as an adverse effect, but it's rarely prohibitive for them to continue using the device. Then the other side effect that's reported is jaw discomfort. Majority of the time is temporary. 1 in 5 patients may report a temporary jaw soreness in the morning that can last up to an hour in the morning and then goes away spontaneously for them. And then the more common side effect that comes further down the road is a potential change to their bite and their teeth positioning and bite alignment. And for that purpose, to prevent that bite change from occurring, we do provide them a retainer to wear for a short period of time every morning as a way of preventing that change.
Okay, and how long do the devices last?
5 years is an average lifetime for an obstructive sleep apnea dental device.
Then it breaks?
Then it undergoes significant wear and tear by that time. That's the average lifetime. If someone has a teeth grinding or bruxism is co-occurrent, then in that scenario, that lifetime is shorter. And then in others, it may last a little bit longer than 5 years, but that's the average.
Okay, that's very helpful. So thank you for all these valuable insights. Do you have any final messages to leave with our listeners?
What I have experienced over these years of serving our patients with obstructive sleep apnea is this close collaboration with our medical colleagues. So this communicative, connected relationship for our patients is the key. So I would encourage any conversation. Feel free to email or communicate with me at any time for your patients. Happy to support.
Thank you so much. We hope you enjoyed this podcast. If so, please tune in again through wherever you receive your podcasts as we discuss further topics in sleep medicine and sleep health. Thank you.